So notice that when we say low text requires both columns to be of the same length, what do we mean? The number of lines of data must be the same for both. You cannot have some columns empty for the, some rows empty for one column, because it is, we noted that arrays are homogeneous data structures. So it has to be filling every value. So for that purpose, you have to ensure that the data is in the right format. So are we all comfortable with loading data? This is the most useful, probably the most common use case you will do. Read existing information into a file, or have an existing information in the form of a file, read that data into variables using load text. We note that load text will directly do the, so much of work it is doing. You read one line at a time, convert, parse it, break it into pieces, convert to float, then load it into an array. All that is done in with one line of code. So unlike primes, it is not a simple sequence. So if you notice, I read it into a variable called LT. The full file name is of not real interest, it is essentially the load text. So now for this to work, both should have the same columns, they are all that we said. Once you have done that, what do you get? You get a single array of arrays, so to speak. Now that may not be very comfortable. You may be more comfortable saying, you know, I want two arrays, so that one is L, one is T. You can do that. If you say unpack equal to true, you will get it nicely unpacked into two things. You can see L is the first column, T is the second column. So whichever way you want, you can get it. You can either get it as an array of two arrays, which I did in LT. So LT gives you one pair, it gives you a list of pairs of L and T values, but it may make more sense for you to have all the L values in one variable and all the T values in one variable. That is done by using the unpack argument. Let us repeat, load text essentially a convenience which reads a set of data, parses it, converts the data type and loads it. It is almost always what you want. Rare occasions, if it is not, you have to do stuff the long way. But in those cases, you are better off using the shell scripting you learn to take the data, chop it into pieces, reassemble it, and then do a simple load text rather than trying to write Python code to change it. All right? Supposing there is some text data, load text will vomit. Anything other than numeric data gives low text indigestion. So the best way is to not write special Python code, instead write a simple bash script which removes the column and then use that resultant file as input to a load text. All right. Now we want to plot L versus T square and produce an approximate straight line. So we have a function called square which we can use. We could also iterate over, we have done for loops and all that, right? We could laboriously go say x equal to something, then x equal to x plus t star t for t in t, all that you could write. But that is not how scientific computing people like to think. You like to write like mathematicians. So simply write plot L comma TSQ like this. Can even do better. And you will get, sorry, CLF would be preferable. You will get a lovely looking straight line like that. If you squint, it even looks like a straight line. Okay. Obviously, this is not the case for drawing a continuous line, correct? This is experimental data, so you should have plotted using points. Are you in agreement? Those of you are awake at least, are you in agreement? Sleepers, we don't have to worry about. So, this is more like it. This tells you that yes, there is a linear tendency and that is about it. Alright. Now please note that in two lines of code, load text, plot, we have managed to read a whole data file, do data conversion and produce a plot. Python is extremely powerful in that sense. And you wrote using fairly simple English sounding commands, load text, does not get more readable than that, load text and plot. You have got most of the way with those two commands. Experimental data also contains errors, we normally do not get, you have limits of error in an observation. So we normally like to do error bar plots, rather than plotting a single point. You plot a symbol that measures the spread within which the point can exist anywhere, alright. So that we do by the error bar. So we now have a 4 column data L, T, the error in L, the error in T is available as 4 columns. We can read it with one line, that slash is for continuing a long line across two lines. So L comma T comma L error T error equal to load text pendulum error dot text, unpack equal to true ensures you get 4 variables rather than and one array of 4 arrays. So you can do TSQ equal to T and then this. Instead of using plot, you use error bar to plot, you will get, no, no, you do not have a capture. So this command reads it, LT, LR, TR, unpack equal to true, reads it into 4. Now we need to, instead of plot, So this is the error bar plot, which essentially captures the possibility of the error in each of our data points. Effectively, when you say error bar, you are drawing that many graphical items. So, which is why your screen will be full of matplotlib objects. For each of the 90 points, you are drawing one graphical object. And there are different formats for how you want to draw them. So, how do you find out what are the formats? Simply go through the error bar man page. If you do not do error based plots, you are not really going to appreciate what is happening. But if you, essentially the idea is all experimental data has some range or tolerance or a range of expected error, rather than plotting a point which is fictitious, because your data is not that. Your data is anywhere between length is L plus delta L plus minus delta L. Similarly, your time is delta t plus delta minus delta t within that range. So, you should actually say my point lies anywhere within this square. So, the error bar, which is essentially a way of saying graphically showing that this is what is happening. As you can see, there is a lot more error in the L side and lot less on the vertical side. The graph is a little any questions? Error bar is essentially a shorthand for one plot followed by 90 plots or 90 line drawing, and you have different format for error bars. Can we move on? You have other plots, yes, the scatter plot, you could do pie charts. In a sense, the plot of L versus T square was a scatter plot in the way we did it. Notice the D type equal to int, type of int, because you do not want years to be shown in the x axis as 2002.0, right? That would not make sense. Nothing special about a scatter plot. Even the L by T square plot we did earlier is a scatter plot. You do not have to call it a scatter plot. Simply say a plot L comma T square with O gives you essentially a scatter plot. Here you do not, are you are not specifying. In a sense, you can think of scatter as nothing but a shorthand for a specific plotting style. It is the same as plot year comma profit comma O. Can we move on? You can do a pie chart, you can do a log log chart, each one of which we will avoid the typing practice, I presume. If you understand what the various features are, you will be able to replicate it. Can we move on? Okay, let us talk about arrays. Like we made a comment earlier, arrays are similar to lists, but arrays are homogeneous, and they are much faster than lists. The slides arrays are faster than arrays in a slightly self-referential metaphysical way, but ignore it, it is a typo, it should be arrays much faster than lists, okay. Because they are homogeneous and immutable, the underlying code can do a lot more of optimization. So that is why arrays are much faster. So instead of list, instead of simply putting in square bracket 1, 2, 3, 4, you have to use the keyword array, A1 equal to array of a list. So it 1, 2, 3, 4 in square bracket is a list that is converted into an array by the constructor array. You remember both load text also returned arrays. Load text returned arrays, linspace returned arrays. So we have been using arrays till now without drawing too much attention to the fact. We have sort of hand waved around them, but essentially arrays are a big business. You can also think of arrays as matrices. You squint in a particular way, they are matrices. So identity 3 gives you a, there is a concept of shape for arrays. Concept of length for arrays does not make as much sense as shape, because length will only tell you one dimension. So shape tells you, please note, unlike length, shape is a property. So array dot property, it is not a function. So identity gives you an array 3x3 unit matrix. Try it out. Identity of 3, try out zeros 4, 5. So what's the idea of zeros? Like, instead of specifying a shape, which is what zeros takes, please note it's a shape, you have to give it a tuple. That 4, 5 within brackets is required, you can't give it. So zeros like, instead of a shape, looks at an existing array and says of the same shape. Why is it better? In a program, you may not know the actual shape of an array you are getting. For example, if you have read through using load text, you do not know what shape it is, but you may want an identity matrix of the same shape for some mathematical matrix operations. So in that case, zeros like or ones like will become useful. You do not have to check for the shape and then create another. Is that idea clear? There is a similarly ones like and ones, empty, empty and so on, and operations on arrays. I will use one of the existing arrays I have. I have one array. So what do you mean by operations on arrays? L star 2 gives me a new array where each element is multiplied by 2. This is what a mathematician would like, would write with a matrix. 2A means a scalar multiplication of a matrix and so on. So you can also write A star A, which will result in not matrix multiplication, element wise multiplication. The corresponding element will be multiplied. So this is one of the biggest advantages of using arrays. Your whole code becomes very, very simple. How many of you are teaching computer science, particularly CS101? I am sure one of your biggest lab exercises is multiplying two matrices, right? We do not do any such thing, we simply write A star B. We do not have to worry about indices, sizes, keeping track, incrementing the index variables, none of that. So this is the power of the idea of using arrays. One of my students in an earlier batch used a phrase which I have started using myself, I carry it. Think wholesale, do not think retail. I like that expression. In Python you think wholesale, you use the array in wholesale rather than one element at a time, okay. So and please remember, arrays are immutable. So you cannot say A equal to A star 2 and things like that, that is not recommended. Similarly, when you say A1 star 2, a new array is created, which is each element is twice the previous one. So you want to use it, you say B equal to A1 star 2 and so on. you are going to have a little bit of a tricky thing with keeping track of the proper, what is properly happening. A star 2, what is happening? A 1 plus 2, what is this supposed to do? All the elements, remember that, think wholesale. Do not think last element, first element, some 2 is added in some corner, no, remember that. Similarly, A 1 star A 2, which is at the bottom, again is, it is not matrix multiplication. All things are element to element. If A 1 plus A 1 is creating a new array whose first element is the sum of the first element, similarly A 1 star A 2 is a new array of the same size, the first element is a product. If you write A equal to B star C, the first element of A is the product of the first element of B and first element of C. Where is that useful? It is useful in some areas, it is not matrix multiplication. Sir, but I want matrix multiplication. Okay, you can get it using a function called dot. So, dot A comma B will give you the dot product of A and B, which is essentially the A dot B, which is the matrix multiplication. All right, in lists we would have seen something called slicing, correct? Same ideas carry over to arrays. Once again, think wholesale. Slices allow you to think wholesale even when manipulating pieces. So, A of 2 is an array. If you have C of 2 comma 3 is another array. Okay. So, your code becomes very expressive and very simple. So, here we have an example, change the last row into all 0, C of minus 1. You could have simply written C of minus 1 equal to 0s like. Now, you do not even want to know what is the size, you do not want to type that many 0s. This is the most powerful facility given to you. To go back to that joke, which is in my opinion very useful, think wholesale. You manipulate arrays like you write in your maths textbook, A star B, A plus B. You do not think in terms of elements, in terms of keeping tabs of things. You would write it like you write in mathematical notation. You can ask again, C colon comma 2 is another array. Which array is this? It is essentially the third column. Not second column, remember indices start at 0, minus 1 is the last column and so on. You want to access a row, you would set C of 2, because C is a 2 dimensional array, C of 2 will give you the third row, C colon comma 2 will give you the third column. If you have done slicing, we are essentially extending the idea a little, that is all. If you have done list slicing, all right. Any questions on how to look at arrays or essentially matrices in a certain manner of speaking? If you, as long as you remember, star is element wise multiplication, not matrix multiplication, there is a separate function available for you to do matrix multiplication. You can say arrays are matrices. Which gives us a very powerful way of doing certain classes of image processing. An image is essentially an array. How? An image has a certain size, so many pixels by so many pixels. Okay? And in each pixel position, some data is available. What is the data? That is all for an image. More than 0 or 1, there is an RGB value. That is a actually 4 integers are there running from 0 to 255, correct? Slightly more noise will convince me you are not yet fully asleep, yes or no? So, essentially an image is a what sized array, P We can do that by doing this. IM read is given available. So, IM read is a wrapper around reading a graphics file and bringing it up, providing it an interface as if it's array data. So, do this, you should be able to see. So if you do this, now I is an array. How do you know that? So the array 300 by 300. That's all. So, how do you do this sort of image processing? Meaning, I just want the top left hand quadrant of this image. How do I get it? We are told this shows, this loads the image. Let us do this IM show. So that tells you, okay, the colors are a little off, but they are red and blue. So given that this is your image and this is loaded into an array, which is an array for all practical purposes for us to manipulate, how do we do certain image processing? Namely, how do I get back this top left quadrant? Time to really wake up and start talking. 00 to 150, 150. How do you do that?
Colon 150, comma colon 150.
I hope you understand this is going up to 0 to 149, which,
yeah,
is okay, which is,
yes,
correct,
yes,
too. Sorry, does not give me anything. I have to do one.
I am sure.
Otherwise, it will show me that. which is we got
0 to 149,
which is essentially what we wanted. So, if you remember, all the manipulation of array is available to you, and the array is loaded as a, the image is loaded as an array, a whole class of image processing problems become simple array manipulation problems. For example, you want to reduce the resolution of an image by picking up every alternate pixel. It is very simple to do. You want the center of a picture, again simple to do. You want to rotate a picture. You can think of whatever you want to do, do the manipulation on the array, and the result as an image gives you what you want. We are by no means suggesting this is the way to do image processing in Python. There is a huge Python imaging library, PIL, and there is OpenCV, which is computer vision library, which is available in Python. So, those are the ways to go if you are interested in serious image processing. But quite often we are looking for some very quick minor manipulation, which is more than sufficient for this sort of an approach. If you want to do serious image processing, you are of course recommended that you pick up the appropriate libraries. PIL and OpenCV come to mind, but fairly often what you need is a very simple tweak of an image. This approach will give you more than enough to do. Here is a laundry list of operations just to complete the picture. Whatever you want to do, you can do in one shot. Think wholesale once again using arrays. Transposes dot t. So, you want to transpose an array or do a consider and operate something as a matrix, it is an array. Dot t gives you the transpose of that matrix. The product, the matrix product or matrix multiplication, as noted earlier, is obtained by using dot. Of course, inverse and determinant are available. There is also a rather peculiar sum. I do not ever recall requiring to add every element in a matrix, but then eigenvalues and eigenvectors, singular value decompositions, all of that is available as a very simple one call function. All right. Once again, just think of, let us do wholesale. You will find one operation to do what you need. You do not ever have to code the nuts and bolts of any matrix manipulation, because it is all done for you already. Be nice later. So, if you look at this, this is essentially the L by T square plot for the pendulum. Now, a straight line does not make any sense. If you were to do this, doesn't make any sense, does it? This line has no relevance, meaning it is ridiculous to draw even such a line. So, what is the correct straight line to draw for these points? We know there is a linear trend. What is the correct straight line to draw for this? So, least square fit. So, least square fit is something which is often useful. So, we can do a least square fit fairly straightforward. Do this. Now comes little bit of heavy lifting. We essentially are saying for each t value there is a m and c we have to find, and in a sense take the best average of m and c. For each l t value there is one m and c which you know can be thought of as existing. That is why there are so many different looking lines. So, if you are able to say in some sense I need to average out this m and c so that I can get a single line, that is one way of looking at a least square fit. So, you have to get used to looking at equations in the matrix form rather than the more traditional form. So, t square equal to m into l plus c. So, t square is this, you can think of it as Tsq equal to a dot p, where dot is the matrix multiplication and p is your mc. Now, if we can find the best m and c, then we can plot, and that is very easily done. Now, you see the use for ones like. What do we need ones like L? That is L, by the way, it is not ones like 1, it is ones like L. Capital L might be nicer. Anyway, you have a built in function called LSTSQ, it returns a lot of stuff. The first is the m comma c. If you do that, you can then plot and see a much better line which goes through the middle of this band, which is how the best least square fit line would be. All right. So, you have the slides with you, I suggest you read this, do the least square fit and show it to me. If you have any doubts, ask. Plot the points and the least square line so that we can see how the least square line is somewhere in the middle of the points for some values of the word middle. The machinery required is stated as LSTSQ, then the transpose ones like, and in order to understand where the ones like comes from, we have written out the equation here. You can see that one column coming. So, you need ones like, and this is in this form. You know L1 is a row vector, so you need to transpose. Without even those things, you should be transposing. But this is why I wanted you to do it, because you are now becoming typing. I say something, you type without bothering what we are typing. Please do not stop that. Just a little bit of extra effort and you can do it. So, run ones like by itself in this. Type ones like question mark, ones underscore like question mark. It will happen. There will be many things which we do not cover which you will need to know. So, go back to the built in help. See, we have this. This is produced by t square, correct? This is produced by L. This ones you require. Where does it come from? Why ones like? Otherwise, you have to find the size and then feed it. The whole idea of ones like is you do not do two steps, find the size and then shape and then say simply this. And these are in this form, but actually L2 and L1 will be in the other form. You need that for multiplication, correct? That is why transpose. I made this point earlier. Okay, the question is, related to something we talked about, precisely showing this, I talked about it. Yes or no? I am a very nasty teacher. I know exactly when I talked about what. Showing this, I said, please note, it is a tuple, we are giving a shape. It is not two arguments, it is not two numbers 4 and 5 that is being given. What we are giving is 4 comma 5, matrix of size 4 into 5. That is different from two numbers 4 and 5. The shape 4 into 5 is different from two numbers 4 comma 5, right? How do I tell you I am passing one shape description rather than two numbers? Good question, but unfortunately it was explained long, long ago. All right? Can we move on? Let me repeat, this is recipe based cooking style. Take this dump, you will get it. 80% reasonable food you will get. Okay. So far, if you notice, we have not written one line of code. We said, okay, how do I get a plot? Type plot. How do I do X? Do this. This whole session is recipe based. How do I get X done? For different values of X, we have done it. How do I get interactive plotting? How do I save to script? For each one, there is one or two points to remember, that is all. But real world work requires putting together lot of these things. For example, a recipe may simply say how to make rasam. But if you want to prepare a feast for 10 people, you have to make 7-8 items. So in that sense, you have to put together many of these, tweak them a little. Once in a while, you might consider calling up somebody, hey, without tomato, how do I make this? So, combination of all of this works, but at a simple level, this whole session is about, you know what, it is very easy to do some fairly complicated things, pretty easy to do. If anyone has ever generated a chart in say C or any other language, has anyone had that misfortune? Do you know how many lines of code you have to write and how much of debugging you have to do with those libraries? Here you get it in one shot, plot A comma B. Now that is the whole idea of covering what we are covering. So both for your own consumption and when you are training other students, please try to focus on how very simply fairly complex things can be done. That is the moral of the story you have to focus on. Don't get lost in all these zeros like ones like commas and full stops. The most important thing is you are giving a toolkit for an engineering or a science student which has incomparable power and ease of use. Two lines of text, a student can read data and get a plot, load text followed by a plot. I cannot overemphasize how powerful and empowering it is. In all this syntax, I do not want us to lose track of why we are doing this program. This is not for filling up those forms and making them jump through hoops to send a wire transfer. That is not the objective of the exercise. Objective is to provide students of science and engineering courses a very powerful, easy to use toolkit. In all this halla, we are forgetting that in our own individual struggles with the computer, with the typing, with all these small letters, with this new language, let us not lose track of that. We are here to reveal how easy many important things are for an engineering student, how easy they are to accomplish in the choice of platform we are discussing. That is why today's whole approach in this whole advanced Python session, you do not see write 10 lines of code to do X. You did not have to write more than 2 lines to do anything, yes or no? Rarely you might have had to do 3 lines. We You will see that continue. You want to solve equations. You will spend more time typing, looking at the slide than actually solving the equation, because solving the equation is child's play. It takes more time to type the damn setup of the problem. Solution is half a second. It takes lot more donkey's work to set up the problem. As usual, you are discussing 1000 by 1000 arrays. They can be loaded in by using load text. Obviously, we are showing 3 by 3 for showing solve. If you are doing large scale optimization problems with matrices of the order of 500 by 500 and their coefficients are in a file, once again load text is your friend. Load it, you got the array, still the same solve. Am I communicating? Let me repeat, it takes lot more time to explain than to do these things. It takes lots more time to type than to do these things. So, how do you verify we actually solved? We know AX. This brings us to one interesting problem, namely floating point round. Original is supposed to be 1 minus 2, 0, but you get some non-zero number. This is actually what we could call machine epsilon, meaning the smallest representable floating point value. Round off error, so the computer decides, you know what, it is not 0. 10 power minus 16 is as good as 0 for all practical purposes, but we do not know whether it is 0. So, there is a built in function called all close, which allows you to verify if they are different, are they different above a significance or below a significance. You know there is a built in round off. So, all close verifies that if there is a difference between AX and B, is that worth considering, is it significant or is it simply carry over round off type of problem. In this case it says all close AX comma B is true, in which that means AX is close to B. In other words, that solution is as good. Okay, once again think of it as a recipe. How do I verify whether it is a solution? Do not verify by saying AX equal to B, instead all close AX comma B. Because all close has that one bit of extra intelligence built in, it checks whether two things are near enough, if you want to use mathematical language, sufficiently near, A minus X less than epsilon for sufficiently small values of epsilon. That is the need for all close. And when you teach, I would also suggest you think about teaching it that way rather than what all close does. All close is something you use to ensure you got the solution, and this is the purpose. Once more, we will spend more time looking at the slide than solving. You want to solve a polynomial equation, you will spend more time setting up the polynomial. Only one bit of thing to remember, the highest degree coefficient comes first. Okay, another half a bit of thing to remember, if a term is missing, there must be a 0 here. If you can remember all this, then you can solve polynomial equations. Simply say roots of coefs, that is it. Now we are obviously this does not draw, we are showing you the drawing to see that 3 and 2 is where the roots are. So, solving polynomial equations is very simple. Now, this actually raises a certain class of problems in the pedagogic and academic world. You have a paper called numerical methods. How many of you have to teach it or have to be around when it is taught? Any of you? In numerical methods, probably they will teach for one whole session how to solve using Newton-Raphson iteration and all that. Obviously, if you are going to use Python to do numericals methods, you have a major problem. In fact, Pune University is having that problem. Somebody decided, oh, Python is so lovely. So, how do you do Newton-Raphson iteration using Python? How do you explain that? I am thinking, this is all. You cannot see Newton or Raphson anywhere here. So if you are going to use this to teach numerical methods, remember it's a bad idea. You are better off using a low level language like C. If you want to use NR to extract a root, go Python way. If you want to understand how to implement any of those algorithms, going to Python is the wrong idea. Because if you are going to use built-in, if you want to write by hand yourself, that's fine, you can write in Python. If you are going to implement, re-implement roots yourself, that is perfectly okay. But do not use the existing library functions to teach any of the algorithms. It's a waste of time. Student will come away, oh, it's all a bloody nonsense. Why are they wasting so much time teaching this? It's simply half a code. That's not what you want to leave them with. All right. This is a, what about x squared minus 5x plus 6? Obviously, no one is ever going to use anything like anything like an artificial thing to solve. You will probably solve it mentally and say x minus 3 into x minus 2 and be done with it, but that is not the point. We are trying to explain the method. But if I have a solution like this, sin z plus cos square z, the 0 of that function near, now we are discussing non-polynomial functions and zeros of such non-polynomial functions, those require a little bit of extra work. What is the extra work? You have to import using this particular mantram, has to be chanted once, and you have to import that f solve. And the argument you have to give to that is a function itself has to be given as an argument. What do you mean by that? So I want to solve sin x plus cos squared x near 0, right. So f solve takes two arguments, the function and an initial value. We wanted near 0, so let us say it says name z is not defined, okay. So we have not really understood how to use f solve, okay. Not much of a news. Note carefully, we do not declare it is not working, we say we have not understood how to use f solve. It is very much working, it is complaining correctly. So how did we solve this? Typically we had a z or ax equal to lin space. Now z we have not defined. Okay, that is the problem. Let us say z equal to, we want the solution around 0, so let us define z over minus 1 to plus 1, okay. Z equal to lin space minus 1 comma 1 comma 200. Now let us run our f solve. It is even more angry now, at least earlier the message could be understood. Now it is saying numpy dot end array object is not callable. Translated to English, it means it expects a callable as the first argument. We instead gave it an array. Why array? Z is an array. So sin z is an array, you know that by now, right. So what do you mean by a callable? We have to give it a function, but f solve is a function. How is it supposed to get a function as an argument? Welcome to the world of modern intelligent languages. Python is a language where functions are first class objects. Functions can be passed as arguments to other functions. Functions can be returned from function as return values. Functions can return multiple values, each one of which will give indigestion to a C programmer and nightmares to a Java programmer. Okay. So, what we need to do, we need to define an executable function and then give it. The way to define a function we already know, I presume. Define f of x is return sine of x star sine of x plus cos of x. Sorry? This is a pure function. X is a placeholder. So, now we go back to f solve and say here we cannot give x because z is the only, we do not have to give z or anything actually, we simply have to give f because f is a function. What do you mean f is a function? Okay, let us see what you mean by f is a function. Functions are first class objects in Python. So, I can do this. Now, alpha is a callable. It evaluates f. All right. So, we need to say f solve, we do not need all that complications, simply say f and you get the answer. The key, the biggest thing we introduced here is the power of the language in that it allows passing a function as an argument to another function. Essentially, what is it doing? You gave it an initial value 0. So, it will evaluate f of 0 and evaluate f of 0 plus some alpha and f of 0 minus alpha. How can it evaluate? Because f is a callable. It will give two values on both sides of 0, evaluate. Then look at it and decide which way it should move in order to go to 0. So, it will iterate many steps and go, that is all. So, it requires the ability to evaluate the function f. So, we need to pass it the function itself. In other words, we need to follow it, pass it a, if you are writing this in C, what would be the closest equivalent for f? Anybody? If you are trying to write the equivalent in C, what will be the closest equivalent for f? This is what is called a thundering silence. That is a function pointer. F is nothing but a pointer to a function, made very simple to use inside Python. No complicated declarations, complicated brackets and stars all over, not knowing which combines faster, nothing you need to know. Functions are first class objects, they get moved around. Do you understand the idea? The function f solve takes two arguments. Sorry, I solved a wrong one. I solved sin square z plus cos z, that is why I got a different answer. But the function f solve takes two arguments. The first is a function. So, we have to define it and then pass it. Note the absence of an argument. We are not passing a specific value. We are not evaluating the function at a specific point and passing that value. You are passing the function itself. Loosely speaking, think of it as we are giving it the function pointer so that the function f solve can repeatedly invoke g, and we are giving 0 as the starting point because we want a root near 0. nonlinear solutions are notorious for instability problems. So, you have to give an initial value which is close to the 0 you want, otherwise sometime they may not converge. Even now they may not, in which case Python will report the first time for 50 iterations there was no convergence. So, you have to either change the number of iterations or say that there is no real solution around that place. For example, it may simply have a point of inflection around that area rather than a function, rather than a 0. So, multiple evaluations on both sides will simply give you different signs, but there is no real 0 there. But those are issues only if you are going to solve very complicated equations. For the purpose of teaching, probably you do not have to worry beyond. The important implication is the functions as first class objects in Python concept. To repeat, functions can be passed as argument to other functions, functions can be returned as return values from other functions, and almost in passing functions can return multiple values, every one of which makes for wonderfully easy, readable and bug free program writing. Can we move on? Okay, ODEs, same story, slightly different chanting to be done this time. From scipy.integrate instead of optimize, you import ODE in, then this is the differential equation you are setting up. Once you have done that, you can solve a differential equation. I suggest you look at it, come up with the plot yourself, and then also look at the next two. Once again, you will spend more time typing than doing, if you appreciate. This is the equation we are trying to solve, dy by dt, the number of infected people is y. So, dy by dt measures the rate at which new people are being infected. We hypothesize it is a product of infected people and non-infected people. And we want to investigate if this is the model of spread. If we say the rate of spread is proportional to the product of the number of people and the number of uninfected people and the number of infected people, then how does the epidemic spread? That is the question we are trying to analyze. And so, we set up a differential equation of this type, and in normal world, what do you mean by a solution? We are used to a solution is y equal to f of t, a function. But when we are discussing numeric or scientific computation, for us the solution is a set of values. For this t value, this is the y value, for this t value, this is the y value. Essentially two arrays are the solution, because we cannot, okay, we can, that is called symbolic. And if you remember Professor Kannan's lecture there, he did talk about symbolic computation in Python also, Sage can do it. But we are not discussing symbolic computation. Regular solution in normal terms means you will produce one set of values for the dependent variable and the corresponding set of, sorry, one set of values for the independent variable and the corresponding set of values for the dependent variable. Then you are deemed to have solved the differential equation. For this t value, this is the y value. So, if I want, I can plot y versus t. I do not attempt to provide a closed form analytical y equal to f of t, where f is some complicated function. That is not the goal of solving of equations in these sort of contexts. Agreed? For example, in the quadratic equation, we do not try to apply b square minus 4ac. We arrive at the number directly, because that is the purpose of this sort of computation. So, once again, setting up takes more time. ODE int, like notice EPID is the function we just now set up, which is essentially translation from maths to Python of dy by dt equal to k into y into l minus y. That is maths translated to Python, the same thing is here. So, that is EPID, right. Having done that, 0 to 12, 61 points over that, then we are looking at 1 year's time, 12 months, 5 points in each month, you can think of it as time, that is the scale you are looking at. So how do I solve, in other words, how do I get the corresponding number of infected people at each of these points of time? At point 0, what is it? At the end of 1/5 of the month, how many people are infected? That is the answer I will get in the Y array. So how do I get it? Simply type Y equal to ODE int EPID 250 T over. Where is the 250 coming from? That is part of the initial conditions. Number of infected people at the start is 250. So that is it. And you will get something like this, which is very cheerful. It says ultimately everybody will get infected, and that is when the infection will stop spreading further because there is no one else to infect. Not very cheerful, but okay, that is what the model is. We are, please remember, luckily we are not applying for a PhD in biotechnology. No one will give us that with this sort of model, but the goal was not that either. Okay. But I want you to appreciate this key thing and also convey the same thing to the students. What is the idea of solving in a numerical context mean? It means arriving at this sort of values, that is all, not coming up with a closed form answer. That is something you will have to convey, because in my experience, students get very confused when they say we have solved it but they do not see a function, because traditionally solving is associated with coming up with a closed form analytic function. When you do your research or your thesis work, you are aware of, no, there is a difference. But the average student may not be aware of this distinction. The next bit is about one more complicated example of a ODE. Here we are showing how we can solve a higher order differential equation by treating it as a system of first order differential equations, because a system means matrix and we know what to do with matrices. We have a lot of functions to play around with matrices, and that is exactly what the next set of the exercise does. Set it up. And you will arrive at the solution, which essentially is the plot of both amplitude and what are the two things you are looking at, and angular velocity as over time, because that is what the equations were set up for. Theta and omega. We decided to solve it as two differential equations, theta and d theta by dt and d omega by dt. So when solved within quotes, you will get theta plotted as a function of time and omega plotted as a function of time. If you look carefully, you will see that when theta is maximum, omega is minimum, etc. You know that when it goes to the end of oscillation, the angular velocity is minimum but the displacement is maximum, and when it comes to the center, the angular velocity is maximum but the displacement is minimum, which is a physical description of a pendulum, which is why where it crosses the 0 and where that crosses 0, both of which you can understand looking at it and say, yeah, yeah, this describes a simple pendulum. Let me repeat, there is nothing interesting or even remotely intelligent about solving using typing ODE int. There is nothing to it. This is the two lines. Setting it up is again bookkeeping work. You simply need to know how to set up your equations, which is more of a bookkeeping work, that is all. Having done that, solving is typing two lines. Of course, you have chosen a simple problem, but remember, more complex problems simply mean more typing to set up. Solution is still the same, one line, pensol equal to ODE into this and that, that is it. You will spend a lot more time typing up this probably. Am I communicating? Stop here for a quick review. Just ran through some of the higher end modules. The key observation with those modules is using them is very, very simple. Once again, it is simply typing half a word or one and a half words to get anything you want. The actual process of using them requires some amount of setup, some amount of bookkeeping. But once you do that, the actual using for solving polynomial equations, for solving linear equations or solving nonlinear equations or solving differential equations is ridiculously, ludicrously simple. If ever you have struggled with doing any of this for actual computation for any particular work, then you will appreciate this lot more. This is given more as see what all can be done, rather than because we expect your students to be solving ODEs using Python as part of their program. I do not know about postgraduate students, maybe they would be requiring, but chances are low for the others. So, for the others, your goal in teaching these sessions to be to show how powerful and easy to use it is, rather than you cannot be taking over the role of teaching them differential equations. We have enough trouble as it is. That is one piece of trouble we do not need. All right.